Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the third hour of Good Day New York, featuring Greg Kelly and Bo Dietl.
My man, Greg.
How you doing?
One question. I got the weathermen over there doing this mini marathon, this cream cake thing. That's not like the 26 miles and all that. Why ain't you? I mean, you got some...
First of all, you are a guest host, all right? Don't be calling the shots. Don't be asking all these questions about... Don't be questioning me at this point.
Are
Bo, seriously, it's good to see you. Yeah, you know what? You're on thin ice, okay?
Oh, okay.
I'm going to be watching you very closely. Rosanna's on vacation. Bo Dietl, a little bit on Bo. Bo, where did you? What was your first job?
My first job was delivering newspapers for the Long Island Press.
No kidding.
I was 8 years old. I used to deliver 76 newspapers before I went to school.
Do you know I was a paper boy for Newsday?
Really?
I started when I was 11.
Yeah, did you remember the Long Island Press on Long Island?
Long Island Press was...
Queens. I grew up in Ozone Park, Richmond Hill area.
And then you became a cop.
No, I was an iron worker, construction worker on the World Trade Center.
All right. Really? You're that old? You helped build the World Trade Center.
I worked as an iron worker in 1969 and 1970. I became went on New York City Police Department.
All right. How long were you a cop?
I was a cop for 15 years.
All right. 15 years. Now, check this out. Bo Dietl, I love this scene. Bo, I first learned of you in the movie Goodfellas.
What do you mean you first learned of me?
That's when I first... I'm sorry, Bo. It was 1990, and this is the first time I ever figured out who Bo Dietl was when he arrests Ray Liotta at the end of the movie. That's Bo Dietl right there. How'd you get this part?
Well, when they first started the movie Goodfellas, Goodfellas was Wise Guy, the book Wise Guy, written by Nicholas Pileggi. So when I first retired, Nick Pileggi called me to his apartment, an apartment on 18th Street. He said, I can't believe you're leaving the New York City Police Department. I want to do a feature story in New York Magazine. I'm sitting in his apartment. He's writing his book called Wise Guy. And he talks about Paul Verio.
There you are in the green T-shirt, by the way, booking Ray Liotta.
Right. And then he starts talking about it. It was all about my old neighborhood with Henry Hill, with the real guy's name was Jimmy Burke. He owned the bar on Lefferts Boulevard. And we started talking. So the next thing is, he says, look, I want you involved with me with the movie, Bo. I said, okay. We go up to Rayo's with Martin Scorsese, Ellen Lewis, the casting director. We end up casting 12 guys, Petey Neck, Mikey, Johnny Rose Beef, all Frankie right. No, all these guys.
All those guys got in the movie.
Yeah.
And it's probably one of the greatest movies ever. Bo, I respect your experience in law enforcement. I also respect his ability as a self-promoter. You can really do it. You are good.
Well,
you are good,
you
Bo.
You know what, Greg? If you're not going to go out, and I tell everybody, I've written a couple of books. I tell everybody, you know what? It's out there. We were at the cerebral palsy thing out in Long Island last night. And I tell everybody, you know, if you want to just sit back and do your job, a lot of the guys go on the police department. They want to get through 20 years and retire. The fact of the matter is a lot of them are out there trying to get their retirement. I say, you know what? Do something when you're out there. Make it change in the crime situation. If someone's dealing drugs, go after them. Become a cop and a real cop. And I always say that to everybody. That's once you finish that, there's a lot more to life out there. The harder you work, the more you get for yourself. If you want to be, complacency is the death of success. Remember that one.
Thank you, Bo. Thank you so much.
A little wisitation for the weekend.
The wisitation. He also speaks in a very interesting way, peculiar to Bo Dietl. I love it.
Mm-hmm.
It was great to have you here. Seriously.
Well, I love you and Rosanna, and I'm sorry Rosanna's not here. I gotta like me and you against each other here because Rosanna usually sticks up for me.
Well, you know, we got some things to debate, and that'll be coming up in a little bit. But now we're going to get to the news. Bo, you saw yesterday, it was a wild day on Wall Street, a negative day. And today, people are nervous. The stock market opens, I think, at 9:30, right? That's when the opening bell is. We're off to a weak start already, though, Bo, because of what's happened in Europe and in Asia. You know, they're ahead of us, Bo.
You know, honestly, I'm a little familiar. I'm also a Fox News contributor. I don't know if you know that.
You're on Fox. I know you're tied with Imus. You're all over the place.
I do Imus. I also do Follow the Money. I do Geraldo. I do Cavuto. I do a lot of the show. I'm a contributor for Fox on the Fox News Network.
And
I kind of follow this a lot. And a lot of people, now it's into panic mode. People have to realize, just don't jump on the panic. Because the panic will end up, you're going to see 20% loss in the stock market. You've got to not panic. Because you've got to look at all the P&Es of these corporations. These corporations have very good earnings. So, you know, you can't panic if you're holding good stock. No
all
matter
right.
what that Wall Street stuff goes down, you know you got a good company. All these companies got the best P&E revenues of all times.
All right. Double check all that stuff with your own financial advisor. All right?
You sound like you're panicking already.
Well,
guys
both.
Like you make the panic.
Trust me.
There's no panic out there, everybody. Hold on to your stocks. Don't panic. That's what it's all about. The company's got great earnings.
easy for you to say, Bo, you got a book under your belt, you got a successful business, let's see, you got a couple of movie credits, you got a screenplay. Come on, Bo. I don't know. I don't know what the answer is.
Do you have stock?
Actually, that's very personal, but okay. Yes, as a matter of
fact. Are you going to weasel out after the show? You're going to sell your stock,
you know,
like
what?
A weasel?
I'm sorry, that's not a weasel. That's not a man
thing. Oh, you're
thing.
Running. You're running. No. You got to stand there and take the shots. Bo, like this. Oh, it's going to drop a little bit, but it'll come back. You see, guys like you caused the 1929.
Right,
boom.
Guys like me. Right, yeah. I just right.
Stand in there. Be a man.
Bo,
be a man.
Be a man. Don't
go
sell.
Down the corner, Greg. Buy a can of man and hold your stocks.
Hey, Bo, I am this close to asking you to leave. Okay, all right, all right. No, I'm just teasing. John Huddy is on Wall Street right now. John, care to comment on what just happened?
I listen, I'm enjoying just listening to you guys. Are you kidding me? I was going to say I'm going to check my 401k as soon as I get out of here. Here's the deal, gentlemen. There is some good news to report at this point. The latest July job numbers came out, and it looks like hiring has picked up. 117,000 new jobs were added. That's above the anticipated 85,000 to 90,000 new jobs, so that's good news. And also, the overall unemployment rate dipped a percentage point from 9.2 to 9.1%. This is good news, certainly after yesterday's Dow Jones tumble, when it went down and when it dropped 513 points, the steepest decline since the financial crisis of 2008. Of course, as we've been talking about all morning, sparking fears about a recession, and also a lot of companies we're hearing have been unloading their stocks, even though a lot of investors, brokers, traders who we've been talking to all morning have been encouraging just the opposite, encouraging folks to hold tight, not to hit the panic button, as Bo was talking about, but to remain optimistic, let things ride, including a couple of guys that we talked to a little bit earlier this morning. Listen to what they had to say.
But I think a lot of people fear that it's worse than we're told that it is, but it's a time thing. It'll take quite a while for it to turn around. Historically, I think, I mean, because I have an economics degree, I think if you look at it, it always will come around. It's just that the valleys are getting a little bit longer.
It's clearly known that Washington has become an enemy of business, and with the projections that this administration has put forth when they first got elected with unemployment and the economy, I mean, they've been completely wrong. I mean, they said unemployment wouldn't go above 8.7% if they did nothing. It went to 10. But I think businesses now are looking for opportunistic type of areas to invest their money in, and if they do that, I think the economy will bode well.
All right, there you go. I mean, the reality is that more jobs really need to be created above that 117,000 that we're learning about that were added last month in order to bring down the overall unemployment rate. So I guess the bottom line here at this point, Bone Greg, is that we are not out of the woods just yet. Guys, back to you.
All right, thank you very much. Aaron Levy was in court yesterday. He's the guy accused of murdering young Libby Kletsky in Brooklyn.
Right.
Remember this horrendous case? Here he is. This is the first time we've seen him in a couple of weeks, Bo. This guy is, well, according to his own lawyers, he may have serious emotional difficulties. Yesterday, we saw his own handwritten confession for the first time.
You know, if we had to analyze everyone that murders somebody, everyone says they have serious difficulties. When I arrested that guy back in 1984 for the Palm Sunday Massacre, we shot 10 people, 8 of them were kids.
At Wendy's, right?
It was on 1080 Liberty Avenue in East New York section. He shot each kid systematically in the head. Then this bunch of jurors in Brooklyn came back with their genius verdict. It was manslaughter because he was under the influence of cocaine. I mean, if you kill somebody and you're drinking, you know what? You have to take some responsibility. This punk here described everything about what he did to that little boy. As far as I'm concerned, you know what? Everybody's a little crazy. You're a little crazy. I'm a little crazy. So at what point do we say, you have to serve the time for what you've committed in our society?
All right, yeah. But, Bo, at this point, look, I mean, the process is unfolding. This is how it works. We can't just, we can't convict this guy until we go through these proceedings.
Right.
Now, the interesting thing yesterday, again, we saw a handwritten confession purportedly from Levy Aaron himself. And what comes through, in my opinion, Bo, is a lack of intelligence, and there's a simple kind of quality to this guy. You know what I mean?
Okay, but so what are you saying? Like, he's not crazy?
Probably not, and I'll tell you why. Because if you read the confession, he seems to understand right and wrong. Now, I'm not an attorney, neither are you. However, my understanding is that when it comes to an insanity defense, you have to establish that you don't know the difference between right and wrong.
And he does know the right and wrong. And we could hear when you speak to him, I mean, he was living his life, and he's living this life for a long time here. And in reality, he should be tried on his competence as being competent to be standing trial.
Because,
that's it.
Yeah, in that letter, he does seem to be aware of right and wrong, and he offers an apology at the end. Let's go to Carolyn Gussoff. She's been following this case closely. She's outside of Aaron's actual home in the Kensington section. Hello, Carolyn.
Good morning, Greg and Bo. This is a process, as you said, and the first step in the process is that Levy Aaron yesterday was found competent to stand trial, but that's still a very long way off from saying that he is sane. All it means when someone is declared competent to stand trial, and really the threshold is very low, it just means that they understand the legal proceedings against them, they understand they're before a judge, they understand the charges. But his attorneys, it certainly seems, are still pursuing an insanity defense. Take a look. He was in court yesterday, and this report was revealed that he's competent to stand trial. Now he has, or his lawyers really have, until September 19th to determine whether they'll pursue an insanity defense. And in that case, it's up to the jury to decide whether he's not responsible by reason of insanity or by mental defect. And that's really very hard to prove. But his attorneys seem to be building the case. They say that he has hallucinations. He's been hearing voices that compelled him to do this, voices that are compelling him to take his own life because of what he did. And also revealed yesterday, as you said, his handwritten confession. In it, it's very matter of fact. It's almost detached as he talks about how he met the boy, how Libby Kletsky asked him for a ride and he brought him back to his house and then killed him and dismembered him. But there are some elements of that confession that do show that he understands what he did. He wrote that he panicked when he saw the missing flyers around the neighborhood. And then he said this, take a look. He said that he went home to clean up and organize. I understand this may be wrong and I'm sorry for the hurt that I've caused. So that might undermine an insanity defense, but yet his own attorneys say they will get their own psychiatrists in there to examine him.
We're seeking to keep him there at Bellevue because he has displayed some psychiatric disorders.
It makes references to it. It's not clear on the issue.
And several other strange parts of this case revealed in court yesterday. First of all, that he had told detectives at one point, I'm famous, almost boasting. And that he also said that he was trying to get back to religion, but he told detectives that he's not keeping kosher, that he'd have McDonald's for lunch. Police say that they gave him Chinese instead. This case is due back in court on October 4th. Meanwhile, he's still at Bellevue Hospital. If, by the way, Greg and Bo, he ends up being found not guilty by reason of insanity, it just means that he would spend possibly the rest of his life in a mental institution, not a prison. That's the latest this morning from Kensington, Brooklyn. Back now to you.
All right, Carolyn, thank you. We're going on to something else now.